Well, I guess my name is Clarence Mixon. I am the third son, or third child for Geneva Curtis, who married my dad, George W. Mixon. Geneva was one of 11 children, and my dad was one of 8. They were the Selma, Alabama, my mom, and my dad was from Camden, Alabama. I have 3 more siblings, a sister who's 2 years older than I am, 83, Evelyn, Herring, and a brother who's 1 year older than I am, Roy Edward Mixon, and then myself, Clarence W. Mixon, and then a younger brother who's 12 years younger than I am, George Mixon. My parents were from Selma, Alabama, and I sort of envy people who have parents who've gone to college, or at least had parents who attended and graduated from high school. My parents, my dad, graduated, finished the 9th grade, my mom only the 6th grade. So they never talked to us about college or education, other than making sure that we finished, we had the working skills, to be able to take care of ourselves, to be independent. Mom gave us endearing love and respect for family. Dad worked his ass off, working 2 and 3 jobs, and was a hard worker, ambidextrous, to pitch one baseball game with one left and right hand, and pitch another game with the left hand, and win both games. And the first two, my brother and sister, sister and brother were born first in Selma, Alabama. And before that, next year when I was born, they had moved to Cleveland, Ohio. And I was born in Cleveland, Ohio. My younger brother was also born in Cleveland, Ohio. We all finished high school. And for some strange reason, I was the first in my family to go off to college. I went on a bet, a dare, with a roommate of mine in the military who bet me that I would be admitted to a college or university. I bet him that I would not. He won. Not only did I finish Kent State University, where I met my first wife, Georgia Rivers Mixon, and I must say that I've been married, divorced twice, and I've been married to 2 beautiful women who did more for me than I did for them. First one helped me, 3 years older than I, helped professionally, career-wise, degrees and credentials, helped me to understand that I could continue my education and supported that aspect of it through not only a bachelor's, but a master's, but a doctorate as well. My second wife gave me the opportunity to have 2 biological girls, one Lindsay, who lives in LA, and Allison, who currently lives in New York City. They both are artistically driven, and even though they like to try and save some of the genes or my artistic genes, even though I have the creative artistic talent, but I was never going to become an artist because of the fact that I was not going to become a starving artist. It's important to me to make a living, it's important to me to take care of my family, it's important to me to make sure that I provided, even if it meant working 2 or 3 jobs, and that's what I do. But I've been blessed having a beautiful family, starting with my mom, my dad, my siblings, and the entire Curtis family. With regards to Big Auntie and Grandpa Walsh and Nathan, Uncle Marshall, Colleen and Eleanor, and even the parents on my dad, family members on my dad's side as well. I've been fortunate enough to not only have finished with a bachelor's degree, but a dual master's and a doctorate in educational higher administration. Ran a private foundation over 32 years, giving $500,000 or better to kids going off to college, and replicating that program in 9 other cities around the United States before I retired with a recognition from the Department of Education and Secretary Bennett and a reception at the White House that year. Since then, I retired about 11 years ago. At this point, I'm simply downsizing and continue to downsize till I decompose. I'm traveling, enjoying life, and life has been great. And I've been very blessed. And I try to make every family reunion that I possibly can. For several years, my Mixon family was having a reunion every year, so were the Curtises. And I was trying to get them to have one every other year, because I was the only person who was flip-flopping back and forth between the two families. My aunt, who's here at this particular reunion, 95, is the last sibling on my dad's side of the family. And 4 years ago, she was no longer able to host and have the family reunions for the Mixons at her place. She was a typical old mother hen who wanted to get all the little biddies to come and sit under her wing and stay with her. So with this particular reunion, her daughters have come, brought her, and now they understand the importance of why I wanted them to come and be a branch of this particular family reunion, because of the fact that it's larger, it is more inspired to look at academic pursuits and education, and it also is concerned about making sure that we gather and share information and understand how to help each other. I know that at this point I'm number 4 in the pet world after my 94-year-old aunt, or at least 95. Then comes my sister Evelyn, who's 83. Brother Roy, who's 82. Quintin, who's 82, and then myself. So at this point, we're at that top tier, and then it drops 10 to 12 years before the next cluster. My brother's age, Big Nate, Larry, and all of them come along, and the Billups. So at this point, I feel a point of just great. Travel as much as I want to, go where I want to go, spend the winters in Florida, and life is wonderful, and I feel blessed. And I want to say thank you, and I'm blessed to be a member of the Curtis Mixon.
Wisdom from Clarence.
I never planned to go to college. I never thought I had the ability or talent. When I graduated from high school, one of the things that, because of my artistic skills and ability, I applied to 3 schools for medical illustration. All 3 turned me down because of the fact that I was black, and they were not admitting any people of color to those schools. It wasn't until I got into the military that I had a roommate who felt that I should continue my education and encouraged me to go. And when I got to Kent State after his winning that Gordon C. Phillips, got to Michigan State, I began to realize that I was not a loner. And I'd look around the dorms, and because I had a barber shop, which I still ran, I was in the military, I never cashed a check. Because between cutting hair, and military, you had to have a haircut every week. Loan sharking, if you wanted $5, I loaned you $5, if you paid me back 10 at payday. I was a battery clerk, it was the first company that I started. I was the only man out of 250 who knew how to type at that particular time. It was in 1954. And when the company commander said they needed a battery clerk, and was any man in the company who could type, I did not step forward.
The French were
in the Army. In the Army, traditionally Fort Knox, Kentucky. Mainly because when I was in high school, I was the first black class president at John A. High School in 1953. And the reason I won, I didn't realize it, was because of the fact that the school was about 40% black, 60% white, as I saw it, but the 60% white with 30% Jews and 30% Italian. And I ran against a Jewish kid, Wolf. And the Italian kids would not vote for Wolf. But there were enough black kids who voted for me, and I wound up being first black class president of the Italian high school. First inducted into the Hall of Fame, first established a program there for minorities. So I've always been not planning anything, but at the right place, at the right time, with individuals saying that this is an opportunity that I think you have to look at. So I've always been gainfully employed and always asked to look at another job or go to another position. I've never had to worry about working or finding a job, and I know it's only because of my credentials. That's why I say to young people that today, unless you have the skills of a...
When you started recording again, what city was this when you graduated high school?
From Cleveland, Ohio.
That was Cleveland, okay.
Okay,
so you
said...
Born, you talked about that, born and raised
born in Cleveland. Yeah, he said all that.
It was older, weird because of...
If you can just finish the thought that you were going on, we can get all the other. You said unless you had skills.
Because of the fact that I've been in education long enough, that I know that I look at, I try to advise young people and say to them, that if you have the type of skills of LeBron James, or if you have the talent of a Michael Jackson where you can sing and dance, if you don't have those two skills, you better get yourself a piece of paper or a credential, whether it's a certificate, whether it's an associate degree, a bachelor's, or a master's. And the purpose of all of it, regardless of whether it's LeBron James or Michael Jackson, or with a credential, is become gainfully employed. That's the bottom line. Nobody wants to take care of another adult. So the sooner you can prepare yourself academically, enough skills, if you put in your trick bag, if you can survive, hope like hell that you never have to pull them all out and use them. But the more skills, talents, and things that you can do to enrich your life, that you can have options to pick and choose what you want to do, the freer you will be. One of the things I say is you can always take a lesson from your dog. That lesson is, no matter how much shit life throws at you, kick some grass over and keep going. Mom died in 69, dad died in 79. She was 57, dad died in 70. The four of us have all passed the 70 benchmark. Now we use our aunt, who's 95, as our benchmark. And I myself personally want to make a big 100 as long as I'm mentally fit and physically able to just have those options. Life is wonderful.
Did you talk a little bit about just your mom and dad and maybe their profession, how your mom and dad wish you
do? Nobody mentioned the fact they had limited education.
Okay.
Mom only had the 6th grade, dad to the 9th grade. But they were, dad and mom taught all the loving skills, love, caring. Dad primarily to be a hard worker, to prepare for your family, to provide, and make sure that no matter what happened, you provide a food and shelter. And also the fact that I was very blessed to have two beautiful wives, and they both need my gift for them. Pushed me to education and academics. She was 3 years older than I am. The second one gave me two biological girls that I really loved. So with that, I can check off all my little squares of manhood and say I've done all those things.
You want to add anything else?
Well, I've gotten away from being in front of the camera. I used to do interviews and soliciting money and presenting presentations with groups. At this point, it's good.
Did you say what you had your doctorates in?
Administration of Higher Education, yeah.
But all that's from Kent State as well?
No, I got my bachelor's. I mentioned it on the table. Bachelor's at Kent State in Fine Arts. and master's education was for dual master's secondary education and guidance and counseling, and then the doctorate of Michigan State and administration of higher education. So I think I've influenced a lot of the family members to start going to college and to pursue advanced degrees, or at least recognize the inevitable and just get on.
So you're Dr. Clarence Mixon.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
When someone called me Dr. Mixon, I know that they know me from professors. They call me Egghead, and I know they knew me before.
And so, could you say the years that you got your bachelor's, master's, and doctorate?
Did I say the years? Yeah. Bachelor's in 1964. Yeah, 64, I got my master's. And then I think it was 72 when I got my doctorate.
And you retired from education?
Yeah. I retired 13 years ago. Downsize until I decompose.
Oh, no, man. You're alive and well, man. So, thank you so much.
All right. Story of racial experiences, things that have happened all my life, to the point that, because many times I was the only one at most board meetings, on most associations, and on boards, to the point that when I retired off of 16 different boards and commissions around the country. Three were national, four were regional, and the rest were local. And being very active in the Episcopal Church, I was the first black person elected to the diocese, to the General Convention, 2 years in a row, I voted for it. And only because of the fact that I was on the boards, and I was on the board with networking, because I found out very quickly the most money, people who give the most money are Jewish people, tradition, and having religion. Italians get more money. Even though they have all their churches, they don't give money to their churches. Lots only give money if they sit on boards and control the money to do what they go to. Minorities don't have the resources or the deep pockets enough to give, but most of the time they spend their money, extra money, helping brothers and sisters and nieces and nephews.
It's not cold to you.
And in that sense, so they can't give as much. And it wasn't until I got to the foundation where I was at, where I was raising, and they said, give me a half $1 million, and I'll get paid. So, yeah, I understand the networking. I remember that's thing that I kept saying to Bob Cook, a guy who was so rich, Jewish guy, he said, Clarence, I can't, my grandkids can't pull out of my grandchildren. And one time I was asking Bob, I said, Bob, you know, I'd like to invest in something. Make some investments, you let me know when something comes up. He says, I don't get the money when you got something going. We're going to be buying some debentures. So bring your money on Monday. So I went home and told my wife about it. So this Bob has an investment. Well, Bob can afford to lose his money. He's rich. He's a millionaire. He's not going to let us lose our money. So I begged her and finally got her to consent that we would take $10,000 out of the bank to invest in these debentures. The debentures with American Spring and Wire. So I didn't know what the hell American Spring and Wire was. I didn't know what debentures were. And so I got to his office that morning. He said, Clarence, bring your money. I said, come. Give it to Virginia. So I gave it to a secretary. The secretary went in and adjusted the spreadsheet, where right on the bottom, the lowest person was $150,000. And they scratched it and reduced it down to $140,000 and put my name down to $10,000. So
make that make decision. The next one up was a half a million, 2 million, and about 10 people on that sheet. So I got into where the debentures are stocks that go on the market before they go public. At that particular time in the banks, they were paying 2-3% interest on if you borrowed money. The venture is going to pay us 10% yield. Every year we got $1,000 back. After 10 years we got our $10,000 back that were the ventures. So Bob says to me, he says, well, where'd you get the money? Where'd you borrow the money from? I said, well, we didn't borrow. We took it out of savings. He said, out of savings? It never dawned on me. One of the first lessons I learned in finance, high finance. But all of those above me borrowed the money at 3-4% investment with a yield of 10% each year. And at the end of the 10 years, they got their whole sum back or they invested it into a lot of stocks. And so, my mind, I didn't think the banks, it never crossed my mind the banks even loaned me something. I didn't have it already saved. Or 20,000. That's helped with 10,000 put in. Every year you got $1,000 check. And at the end you got your $10,000 back. All those people made money. And they borrowed it. They didn't take any money out of savings. They made your lesson in high finance. When you don't know, you don't know. Good lesson. Bob Copeland is very, very good, and so I say there, we need good white folks and we need good black folks. Because there are limited opportunities that we just don't do that. So it's important to stay there. All right, I'm going to get out of here. Leave you folks.
Thank you.
Great talking to you.
Thank you.
Well,
good. Man, you got Roy. Super entrepreneur, you got plans,
constant
plans. I'm gonna go try to take some time out one of these weekends to do some editing. Get her information for her.
She's there in Florida. When she gets back there.
In Florida?
Yeah. She's in Haines City.
Yeah, she's like 3 hours away from
I don't think that's about 2 hours.
Yeah, so I gotta go there. And we'll start putting all this together. It's gonna take a while, bro. I'm just gonna keep putting it together. I'll get the family tree right there. I'll get the pictures and then
don't forget about your
family. Yeah,
I'll be on
your family. Alpha's gonna be going to Mary Widow to Chicago for 3 months.
When?
That's why she didn't make this reunion, because she's in rehearsal.
Yeah, I'm going to be in Chicago in late July, definitely all of August.
She's going to be there for 3 months.
Where's she staying?
In the Mary Widow.
But